Y'all don't mind. Let's go back to a time when we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, the Spirit and in truth.
I love them old church.
That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing.
You knew exactly what he was gonna say. Sisters got happy.
I love them old church.
Folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and all of a sudden, he break off in a song, something like this.
So this morning, I want to start a series of lessons. I don't think I'm going to be able to finish it, but I think we'll learn from it. But I want to start a series of lessons called The Seven Times Jesus Bled for Me. The seven times that Jesus bled for me. A more topical lesson would be a bloody blessing. Look at your neighbor and say, a bloody blessing.
A bloody blessing.
Young men did a good job this morning. Right. Praising God. They were praising God this morning. I was off a page. They were on the right page. Look over there and see where they were. They were on top of it. You get on the right page. And so, young men, you got to keep it up. Keep it up. God bless you. And that's what's important. We leave a legacy and example for these children to follow. And they worship God the way he be worshipped. Hebrews 9, verse number 22, just say amen, we have, and I want to arrest your intelligence just for a minute, put a warrant out for your intelligence arrest, and then we'll set bail shortly and release you back to your journey. Amen. Hebrews 9, verse 22. Very important lesson. Now, the first thing that you and I have to consider is that we will never truly have an appreciation or an infinity for God until we understand that we are bloody people receiving a bloody blessing.
Yeah.
Until you understand the blood of Christ will always be subject to humanism and emotional tyrants concerning the work of Christ. It is this backdrop in which the unknown author of the book of Hebrews writes his lesson to address the atrocities and the hideous behaviors of Roman leadership who are killing Christians because they identify Christ as the Son of God and the Savior of the world. It's not only the murders that take place, it is the people of the text who found themselves drifting back into Old Testament principles of the killing of bulls and goats, and that is addressed in Hebrews chapter 10, where he talks about how there is no comparison between the blood of Christ and the blood of bulls and goats. I think the battery just went out. And so, as we look at this and we take for consideration, I want to allow your mind to just place this here in infinity. For if you don't ever learn anything else, this will save your life. Mm-hmm. And that is that nothing that was done for us was done without blood. Not a work that God establishes does he do it in his deity and just makes it happen. But everything that you read about from Genesis to Revelation is because of the blood of Jesus Christ.
Man.
And had it not been for the blood, one writer says in 1 Peter chapter 1 that it is the precious blood of Jesus. Had it not been for the blood, there would not have been the clotting. Had there not been the clotting, then we would have simply bled to death. Mm-hmm. And so when I look at the book of Hebrews and look at verse number 22 in chapter 9, the Bible says that almost all things are by law purged with blood. Uh-huh. And without the shedding of blood is no remissions of sin. Without his blood, you cannot ever establish another church. Mm-hmm. For the blood is what purchased the church.
Amen.
And when Jesus bled for me, the first time that he bled to undo the curse of the flesh. Mm. He bled because he has to undo the Old Testament principles that the Seventh-day Adventists, Jehovah's Witnesses, and others still try to follow. He bleeds to establish the covenant of Abraham and man today. What do you mean? Well, look quickly, if you will, at Genesis chapter 17. Verses 1 through 5, you find that Abraham is instructed to begin circumcision. Circumcision is the cutting away of the foreskin of the males. It is then that God changes the name of Abram to Abraham. But he couldn't just change the name. In order for there to be a change, and stay with me if you will, in order for there to be a change, there had to be some
blood.
Some blood. Mm-hmm. All right, let me start over again. The Bible says that all things, verse 9, look at the text. The Bible says in verse number 22, and almost all things are purged by the law, are purged with what?
Blood.
All right. Mm-hmm. God didn't do anything without some blood being shed. Mm-hmm. In order to establish the covenant for Abel, God has to first provide some blood.
Man.
And without blood, changes cannot be made. Abram's name changed from Abram to Abraham. Mm-hmm. The Abrahamic covenant of God was not just established for Abraham, but Abraham's covenant is for all of us who will come after Abraham.
Amen.
Including the children and their children and their children. You might remember in Acts chapter 2 and verse number 38, the Bible reads that for the promise, verse number 39, for the promise is not only to us, but the promise is unto our children, those who shall come after. Well, what are you saying, preacher? That when God blesses Abraham way back in the Old Testament, he is also establishing a blessing not only for your parents, but for your children. God blesses Abraham in a private place so that we can worship him in a public place today.
Man.
And in order for him to bless us from the Old Testament to the New Testament, there had to be a shedding of blood.
Man.
Are y'all with me? All right. That's the first time. He bled for us in circumcision. The circumcision that we have is not the circumcision of the flesh, but it is the circumcision of the heart. Am I right about it? The Bible declares that in Ephesians chapter 2, around the 13th verse, but now in Christ Jesus, ye who were sometime afar off are made nigh by the blood of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. Well, how are we made nigh by the blood of Jesus Christ? From the circumcision of Abraham, we were without God. We were without a relationship with God. But because of the blood that begins to be shed for the first time, from Abraham all the way to Jesus, we now are lifted from the curse of being outside of Christ and brought into Christ by the blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You are where you are, and you are who you are because of the blood of Jesus Christ. Y'all need y'all shouting for it right here, don't you? Aren't you glad that when he bled the first time in circumcision, it wasn't just for Abraham?
Uh-huh.
When he bled so that your children no longer have to be the tail, but now they can be the head.
Amen.
When he bled in circumcision, he made a covenant agreement that now challenges the curse that was given back in Genesis chapter 3. In Genesis chapter 3, we were cursed. The ground was cursed. Man was cursed. Everything was cursed. Let me show you this very quickly. Because of the blood, we have the reversal of the curse in the garden.
Mm-hmm.
For a person to want to go back to the Old Testament and the Abrahamic covenant would mean that they want to go back behind the blood
undo the bleeding that God did. As if his blood wasn't good enough. You can't go back to behind the blood and eliminate baptism in the blood, because when you do that, you go back to the curse that's in the law. What God does with the blood is he moves us from the curse to the help that's in the blood.
Amen.
So when he makes a covenant with Abraham, he has to undo what he did in the garden. So the second time he pleads for me, one of the curses in Genesis chapter 3, around verse 15, the Bible said that God spoke to Adam and said to Adam, when you work, you'll work by the sweat of your what?
Brow.
By the sweat of your brow. But because of the blood of Jesus, Bible said in Luke chapter 22, around the 42nd verse, that when Jesus was in the garden, he was in the garden, he began to bleed. His sweat was like great drops of blood falling from his head. Because Jesus bled, we no longer have to sweat by the
brow.
By the brow. Because of the blood that he shed, now he undoes the curse of the law and the commandments that were written there. Y'all look at me funny. Because whenever you bleed, you begin to blot out. Colossians chapter 2, verse 14, blotting out the handwritings and orders that were contrary to us, that were against us, taking them out of the way. But what do you say? You can therefore let no man judge and meat, drink, or holy day. In other words, all that stuff that we live under the curse of the law has been taken care of by the blood of Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
But the only way you can change the Sabbath day, and the only way you can change the worship day, and the only way you can change the punishment, and the only way you can change the condemnation, and the only way you can change anything or establish something, somebody had to bleed.
Amen.
And if there was no blood, we would still be under Saul and Abraham, Abrahamic culture. Watch this very quickly. Bible says in Genesis chapter 3, turn your Bible with me if you will, just for a minute, and look at these curses that are put on man because of man's sin and their folly, and we still serve a good God. The Bible says around verse number 15, and I will put the enemy between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, it shall bruise your head, and thou shall bruise his heel. And unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception, and in the sorrow of thou shalt bring forth children. And thou shalt be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. And Abraham said, he said unto Abraham, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat thereof. Cursed is the ground for thy sake, and in sorrow shall you eat of all the days of thy life. The thorns and thistles shall bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herbs of the field, and in the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread. That was a curse that was given to man by God. But in Luke chapter 22, man is sleeping a stone throw away from God. And it's not man that's sweating, but Christ is sweating. Well, what are you saying, preacher? Christ sweat for us, so we don't have to sweat
no more.
Y'all like me shouting. I'm saying 10 people for the Holy Ghost. He sweated for us, so we don't have to sweat anymore.
Amen.
Don't you know sometimes it's not that you're so good, but because of the blood of Christ, God makes things happen in your life that probably should not have happened while you laying out in your bed asleep.
Amen.
When you have a covenant relationship with God, which you got because of the blood of Christ, once you're in the blood of Christ, God sweats for you.
Amen.
For we are not saved ourselves, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4, but we are saved by the grace of God. By the grace of God, through faith in God, we are saved by the blood of God.
Amen.
We should say an old song, I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. His blood being is seen as a consolation, which means that it is a release, it's a relief, it's a solace, it's a securer, it's a support. Jesus sweating, he is sweating to lift the curse off of me. He sweat, he bled, he hung, bled, and died in order to lift the curse. And I don't know about you, but I don't ever want to go back to the Old Testament. I don't ever want to go back to the old ways. I want to enjoy the blood of Jesus Christ. Yes, indeed, it is a bloody blessing.
Amen.
You know, you have to be a cold-blooded person to walk around here in sin when the blood of Christ has freed you from sin. Mm-hmm. Not that you won't sin, but the text says, for without the shedding of blood, there would be no remission for sin.
Amen.
Some people seem to think that means that in Matthew chapter 26 and verse 28, he said, this blood is the blood of the New Testament. That means that since I can sin, because there's the blood of Christ, that's not what it means. It simply means that God is simply saying that this blood is the blood, not because of sin, but for the remissions of sin. Not because of sin, because if it was because of sin, he'd have to keep bleeding. He can never stop the bleeding. But he said this is for, ace is for the remissions of sin. God bled so that sin no longer had power over you.
Amen.
There was one time you could sin. You could commit adultery. You could commit fornication. You could commit all these different types of atrocities, and there was no blinding of the sin. There was a constant reminder of the sin, but then the blood came in.
Amen.
And when the blood came in, it took away the guilty, just the guilty stain. It took away the condemnation forever in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Y'all be like, I'm going to talk about it. Let me show you very quickly. One of the things that we must remember, the third time he bled for humiliation. The Bible says Isaiah 50 and verse number 6. Someone get that for me. Isaiah 50 and verse number 6. I want you to see this. Because if it was not for the blood, we would live our lives in our past sin. And I don't know about you, but every now and again, I got some stuff I don't want popping up again. Y'all ought to say amen.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but if the only thing that stopped, the only reason you can hold your head up because you received a bloody blessing. And the reason that some of us are still tied into our stuff is because we haven't gotten the blood.
Right.
Because if I don't understand the blood, then I shouldn't let my past predict my presence.
Amen.
But when I understand the blood of Christ, y'all ought to say amen. When I understand the blood of Christ, I don't care what I did in the past, the blood starts to clot stuff. And you can talk about it all you want to, but I'm not going behind the blood. Because of the blood of Jesus,
amen,
I can look forward. Watch this. What was happening? The text says it prophesied of Christ, I gave my back to the smiters and my cheeks to them that plucked off the hair. Now I want you to know culturally, when they're beating Jesus and they're smoking him, they're pulling all the hair off his face. Because in other words, they're trying to say that he has shamed himself. In other words, they're trying to shame the face of Jesus. And they're trying to shame the face of Jesus. Right now, we are the face of Jesus. The Bible says, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. The Bible once again declares that by the way we love each other, all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love one for another.
Amen.
But some folks are still trying to shame the face of Jesus.
Amen.
Some folks are still trying to pluck his face, pluck the hairs out of his face. And if you don't watch it, you'll drop your head in shame because you are a Christian, but you made mistakes in your past, and without blood, your past will live in your presence.
Mm.
Ah, but the blood of Jesus. Y'all ought to say amen.
Amen.
But the blood of Jesus, somebody said, if any man be in Christ Jesus, he's a new creation.
Amen.
The old things are passed away. I don't care what I used to do. I know that I made some mistakes along the way. I don't care how imperfect you might have found me. All I can tell you is, but the blood of Jesus. You want me to hold my head down, but I'm not going to hold my head down. Because I've learned in the word of God in Romans 5 and verse number 3 that I've learned that patience bring about the experience, and experience bring about hope, and hope maketh us not ashamed. I don't have to hold my head down because I know who bled for me. You don't have to hold your head down for what you did last year because you know the blood covers you. And because you're covered by the blood, you can do like the psalmist said in Psalm 24. The Bible says, the psalmist 24 said, lift up your hands, all ye gates. It didn't say drop your head. Don't you ever come to the house of God with your head down because you didn't do quite right this week. You ought to lift up your hands, all you gates. Lift up the doors, ye everlasting door. Why? Because the Lord will come in, but he got to Some people spend all their time in your past trying to figure. They weren't even there in your past.
Amen.
They can tell your story better than you tell your story. They sit around and get the line. You start thinking you did it. The line for you sit around and say, I know I was there in 1983, but I didn't know you were there. How do you know what I did? And I don't remember that point. Y'all, I say amen. All right, Pastor. But God said, I'm going to throw it in the sea of forgiveness that you don't have to worry about. I'm not going to worry about it anymore myself. Why? Because the blood of Jesus is just that powerful. This is the last warning, and I want to stop here and pick up next week. But then he bleeds a fourth time. He bleeds not only in the humiliation. You remember Cain and Abel in Genesis 4 and verse number 14. I wish I had a napkin up here. I got one. In Genesis 4 and verse number 14, you see, you ask not, you have not, but I ask for it. God had one in my back pocket. Demon knows and I praise God anyhow.
Amen.
But Genesis 4 and 14, Cain and Abel were humiliated. Abel couldn't look at the face of God. Moses in Exodus 3 and verse number 6, because there was not the shedding of blood then, found himself not able to face God. Am I right about it? You remember Genesis 3 and verse number 8? You remember that it was Adam and Eve that after they sinned couldn't face God. But because of the blood of Jesus, because of the bloody blessing, now we can face God even though we've sinned and erred in our life.
Amen.
You can still face God.
Amen.
Oh yes, the fourth time. He bleeds. He bleeds because of the most vicious beating known to mankind. And I want you to underscore this, because when folk are trying to hurt you, they design and they form the most powerful tool that we have today. It is not in the 9mm. It is not in a switchblade or a knife. It is not even in a terrorist bomb. But the most powerful tool of destruction that exists on earth today is the tongue.
Amen.
That God gave us. Sometimes, well, y'all know I'm right about it. The Bible says in James chapter 3 that the tongue, behold, we put bits and other things, mouths, we control them, but the tongue can no man contain.
Amen.
That tongue was spread stuff that it ought not spread, whether true or false. That tongue was say stuff that you didn't mean. That tongue was spit out of turn. That tongue will start a lie in California that'll make it all the way to New York. That tongue is something else.
Amen.
That tongue will speak against God if you don't watch it.
Uh-huh.
Nobody say amen.
Amen.
You know what? Every night you'll holler at God in a heartbeat. You'll say, cuss words so fast, your head will swim. That tongue will get you. Think I'm lying? Hit yourself with a hymn unexpected and watch what come out your mouth.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all look at me funny. Y'all ain't never said a bad word before.
Mm-hmm.
I know some of y'all are cussing. You done cuss me.
Sure.
Amen. Amen. And so it's interesting as we actually read the passage of scripture, because in the crucifixion, he bleeds for me five times. And only two other places he bleeds for me. He bleeds for me in the circumcision in Genesis chapter 17. He bleeds for me in the garden in Luke chapter 24. In his bleeding for me, he will undo the things that God rightfully had a right to put on me for me and sin. But because of the blood, that's why y'all are glad you are bloody people following the blood of Jesus.
Man.
And you've seen the bloody blessing. Because of his blood, we're free from the curse back in the garden. Y'all are saying amen.
Man.
Whenever somebody come walking up talking to you about what you did and what you used to be and what you're going, you just tell them, oh, but the blood.
Man.
Look at your neighbor and say, oh, but the blood. Oh yeah, when your husband makes you mad, he talks you crazy, tell me how, what you got. You say, oh, but the blood. Oh, amen, y'all. I say amen now. Whatever your wife messes with you, say, oh, but the blood. Amen. Y'all ought to shout right now. When folk think they know your business better than you know you ought to say, oh, but the blood. Can y'all just stand up right now and shout right now, oh, but the blood, Jesus. Praise God. Now watch this. Watch this, and I'm gonna sit myself down and just stay working. I'm through. I just want to get this done, and I want to show this is significant. For a long time, we read about the cat of nine tails. It was literally made with glass and sharp objects on the end of them. So when they got Jesus back spread out, who said he was the Son of God, who was saving you and I. And even those who didn't know they were going to be saved, every lick was designed to be percussionist. It was not just to hit the surface. But the lick was to hit the surface and cut into the flesh and to pull meat from it. They gave Jesus. Now watch this. See, God doesn't do anything. God doesn't do anything. When we read stuff in the Bible, there's not this insignificant. They gave Jesus 39 licks, which meant his back was ripped open 39 times. 39 times. Isn't it interesting? And I'm going to sit myself down. Jesus' back was open 39 times, which meant he bled 39 different places. And today we have 39 categories of 39 categories of disease, 39 places of blood, which would heal 39 categories of disease. Now that catches me. I was from Midian once myself. That catches me on your way home. 39 open spots of blood that has more power than the 39 categories of sin that we see today, or disease that we see today. What you saying, preacher? There is no weapon formed against us.
Amen.
That will prosper.
Amen.
I don't care what it is, because God's blood covers all manner of diseases. God's blood heals all manner of diseases.
Amen.
And if you pray to God and say, God, help me, I don't care what you're dealing with, God has the right, because of the blood, to heal every category of disease. If you got sugar diabetes, you need to turn it over to Jesus. If you got arthritis, you need to turn it over to Jesus.
Amen.
If you got HIV, you need to turn it over to G-O-D. I don't care what you're dealing with. He received 39 lashes, 39 open wounds of blood. There are 39 categories of diseases. It means that the disease is not bigger than the blood.
Amen.
Y'all gotta say amen. And so then, preacher, what's all this preaching about? Well, as I come to a temporary closing spot, it's suggesting to you that Jesus has bled for you so far four times that I've shown you. And that every time that he bled, it benefited us. It meant that some of you are standing here right now, back behind the cross, still messing with stuff that the blood has freed you from.
Amen.
Some of you are sitting here right now. You have an entrepreneur spirit. You remember when Jesus was praying, he was sweating. The Bible says he was a stone throw distance from his disciples. Now watch this. That meant that the stone limits the boundary of where the disciples could go.
Mm-hmm.
The stone was an indicator of how far they could go.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus is beyond the stone. There are some stones in your life in which the enemy has rolled up in front of your tomb, saying you can't go no further than that. But Jesus is right outside that boundary praying for you. And the Bible tells me that when they put Jesus in the tomb, that an angel came and rolled the stone away. Well, what are you saying, preacher? I don't care what stone is in front of you, pray to God. The angel will roll your limitations away.
Amen.
And God will resurrect in you a powerful person who can...